Do you know how I walked to my car? Jauntily. I swear to God, jauntily. I'd completely flushed my career, but I felt wonderful. I was a Rob Garland I'd been before, ready to move on, ready to marry Joe and for us to live a carelessly normal, utterly bog standard, blissfully mundane life together without a doubtful thought passing through my head ever again. As I walked along, I puffed misty little breasts up into the cold night air and pretended to be a train. Central FM's car park had space for two cars. The only reason it was called a car park at all, rather than simply a small driveway, was that a genius had put up a sign that said, car park. It was a bit like laying laminate flooring in your living room so that accidentally a 2-inch height difference where the surfaces meet in the middle, and addressing this problem by simply referring to the higher area as the mezzanine. Managing to get space in Central FM's car park was such an astonishing achievement that, had I ever managed it, I'm sure I'd have never moved my car again. I'd have just left it where it was in triumph and walked home. Because, as usual, there hadn't been a place free when I'd arrived, I'd done what I always did and parked my car out in the street. Sometimes this meant parking several hundred yards from the station, but there wasn't really a choice in the matter. And on one level, it was quite exciting, in fact. To park your car out on the street at night in Birmingham and find it still there when you return a few hours later always gives you a surprise little thrill. This night, however, I managed to find a place reasonably close. I walked out of the car park and reached into my pocket for my keys as soon as I turned to head down the street. I jangled them in my hand for only a moment before I was already close enough to aim at my car and, neep, turn off the alarm. There's something about setting or unsetting a car alarm that makes you look around. I don't think the impulse is as fully formed as expecting to see a group of joyriders whoop, no, and storm in the second you disable the thing. But it's certainly that kind of notion bubbling up indistinctly from your subconscious. So I followed my switching off the alarm with a quick glance back up the road. That was when I saw him. Instantly I knew he wasn't right. It was 3 a.m. in a part of the city where only returning jazz radio presenters had any call to be on the streets at that time of day. So that alone made me suspicious. That was the least unsettling thing about him, however. A more uncomfortable aspect of his even being there at all was the fact that he'd obviously been waiting in the darkness of the micro car park. He was walking out from it onto the street exactly as I'd just done. The only reason I could imagine for his being there was that he was trying to break into one of the cars. And that would have been fine. Better than fine, actually. I think one of them was Keith's. And that would have been fine if he'd hidden as I walked past and then carried on. Or, panicked by my appearance, bolted off up the street as soon as I was far enough away. But he was neither running nor hiding. He'd come out of the car park and was, at a calm but brisk pace, following me down the road. Glowering above even these two shivery truths, however, was the signalling wrongness of the fact that he was wearing camouflage fatigues. Who wears camouflage fatigues in the street apart from the worryingly disturbed? Everyone knows they are the chosen uniform of the mad. So, a psycho was coming after me in the semi-darkness of a deserted road in the early hours. Worse still, a big psycho. Not one of those psychos who read SS books and fill their room with replica weapons, but who are, tellingly, 5'6", 7 stone, and can be disabled, if not killed outright, by simply knocking their inhaler from their hands. Oh no, such luck. This was a big psycho. Tall, heavily built, and his head, just in case there was any doubt that he was a nutter, shaved so that only a short psycho bristle covered it. Oh, he was staring right at me too. He wasn't even making any attempt to hide it. Looking back, even across the distance that divided us and in the poor light of the street lamps, my eyes connected directly with his, and he deliberately held them. Continuing to walk, I turned back around towards my car. My mind sped through the possibilities. If someone grabs you from behind in a neck lock, then you stamp your heel down hard on the midsection of their foot while simultaneously pulling their arm away, using the awkward twisting of their wrist joint to force them to yield. Knife attack, grab the hand and elbow of the attacking arm and push both inwards. The way the muscles are arranged means they have no real strength in that direction. A face-on attack, of course, you meet with a sharp upward blow using the heel of your palm, driving the attacker's own nasal bone into their brain and killing them instantly. The only questions were, what was my best move, and when was the best time to make it? I felt I shouldn't wait for him to snatch the initiative. I should act, not respond, see that the situation played out on my terms. So, I screamed as loud as I could and ran like buggery for my car. I was at the driver's side door in seconds, but it was a million years later than I would have preferred if I'd thought I'd terrified Camo Killer into a scrambling retreat by unexpectedly racing down the road away from him, shrieking like a six-year-old girl. Then I was wrong. He was obviously made of sterner stuff than that. Not only had he taken the opportunity to escape, he had now actually begun to race down the road after me. My eyes bulging, I stared at him over the top of my car and screamed at F-sharp above top C one more time just to show my meant business. But he kept on coming, using what suddenly appeared to be somebody else's fingers. I fiddled frantically with the door, furiously wondering why Renault, it seemed, had decided to produce a car with a millimetre wide lock that needed to be opened using a key the size of a hover mower. While I stood there, fumbling, Camo Killer hammered along the pavement towards me. He was now only a few feet away. My bowels plummeted to the earth's core. Finally, I somehow managed to thread the shuddering key into the minuscule hole. A twist, a pull, and a leap, and I was inside the car. I slapped a peg down the door to seal myself in and started the engine. Only then did I allow myself a glance in the rearview mirror. Bizarrely, my would-be assassin was nowhere in sight. Ah! That would be because he was just rounding the car so he could throw himself on the bonnet. Glad we cleared that one up. He was leaning forward on the front of my car now, arms stretched straight down in front of him, supporting his weight. His eyes were wide and searching and flooded with a look that was vivid with intensity and the colour of brain crazy. The pure shock and fear of seeing him suddenly there made me snatch in air and jerk backwards. I hit the headrest and bounced forward again. The whole time, I couldn't look away from his eyes. All this took perhaps only seconds, but it felt like long, icy minutes of him locking my gaze to his. It reminded me of the way, in films, Dracula's sinister power holds the eyes of his virgin victims. Oh God, maybe it was sexual. Maybe he was going to shag me, then drink my blood. Christ, he was going to shag me, then drink my blood. Shit, this wasn't fair. This simply wasn't fair. I'd just got my life sorted out, and now a nutter was going to shag me, then drink my blood. God, I hate Birmingham. His mouth began to move. He was going to say something, possibly shag, then blood. I leaned forward slightly, transfixed. The car engine was a deafening, ragged howl now. I was in neutral, but my foot was panicking down hard on the accelerator. Above, the shuddering, ear-stabbing noise, the voice of Camo Killer roared through the horribly fragile barrier of the windscreen, roared right into my face. What's your name? Not really what I'd been expecting him to say, I must admit. In fact, it threw me so much, I drew in a breath and was about to shout back, Rob, before I caught myself and was heading towards, who am I? Who the fuck are you? Before I remembered that he was a madman bent on shagging and killing me. Of course he hadn't said anything I'd expected him to say. That's how nutters function. They say, apropos of nothing, you got my aunt's sofa. And then they stab you. Because they're nutters. I clamped my mouth shut and wrenched the car heavily into reverse. But then I flinched my foot off the clutch and the car lunged backwards so quickly that my head flew forward and hit the steering wheel right where my hand was holding it, thus hurting both my head and my hand. I really was having no luck at all tonight. The agony lasted only a flicker, however, before the natural painkiller of distracting, constricting terror swept it aside as I realised I'd pulled back too frantically and stalled the car. The silence of the engine shook me by the ears and, my breathing jammed in the off position, I twisted the car key damn near hard enough to snap it as my own voice screamed in my head, don't snap it, you stupid! stupid fucker! Camel Killer had been briefly unbalanced with the car he was resting on and leapt away from under his hands. He didn't go as far as to fall, though, which I thought would have been the decent thing to do. He merely lost his physical equilibrium for a moment and was then back in control. Back in control and beginning to come towards me, looking, it's safe to say, miffed. I rung the key in the ignition again. He marched forward, but not to the position he'd occupied before. He came round the side of the car this time, heading towards my door. The engine caught. He started to crouch down. He was so close now, I could see the folds of fabric curling around where the powerful bulk of his upper body distorted his camouflage top. He reached out for my door handle.